This is LWO 80062, tape number 12, side A. These are acetate tapes of America's Town Meeting of the Air. This is cut A1, tape number 24, which bears no date. The subject was how can government and business work together. The guests were Wendell Wilkie and Robert H. Jackson.
Tonight we bring you a program that is a typical example of the kind of thing America's Town Meeting of the Air was founded to present. Now this is not a debate in the conventional sense. It is not our purpose to widen cleavages, but rather to find common ground upon which all classes and all groups of American citizens may work toward our general welfare. How can government and business work together? That's our subject, and I know of none more interesting or important for this nation at this moment. We've been extremely fortunate in securing as our speakers the Honorable Robert H. Jackson, Assistant Attorney General of the United States, and Mr. Wendell L. Wilkie, President of the Commonwealth and Southern Corporation. At the close of their addresses, we will have the usual question period from the audience. And now it is my very great pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Mr. Robert H. Jackson, Assistant Attorney General of the United States. Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Chairman and friends of the town hall, probably no two men who personally respect each other enough to appear in public together could look at the relations of government to business through more differently colored glasses than Mr. Wilkie and myself. I have admired his consistent willingness to stand up man-fashion and submit his views to the test of dispassionate but frank discussion. That is the only process by which a democratic people can reach decisions on conflicting policies. I have recently paid my respects to that small but loud section of business which has been ganging up on democracy. So tonight, I can address myself to that larger audience who submit their case to the sound judgment of democracy. Business means one thing to Mr. Wilkie and another to me. In professional life, I was a lawyer, chiefly, for what we would call small business. My stake in that is far more permanent and important to me than any stake in politics. And in government, my particular job is to try to use the archaic antitrust laws to preserve this same kind of small and independent business. Mr. Wilkie, on the other hand, has become not only one of the outstanding lawyers for big business, but his mastery of finance and administration has carried him to the presidency of one of the largest public utility holding corporations in the nation. Small business, of course, has its problems with government, one of the chief of which is the correction of inequities in the tax structure. But it is chiefly big business that is at war on many fronts with government. The most constructive thing we can do tonight is to analyze the reasons why they do not get along. First of all, there is one thing which the people expect business as a whole somehow to do. That is to furnish steady jobs for all who want to work and to furnish enough goods to make up that standard of living which we have come to regard as American. The public is convinced that a proper economic arrangement in a nation of such unlimited resources can give that, and so am I. First, we look to business for it. But if industry will not provide it, the people are determined to provide it for themselves through their government. This nation has repudiated for all time what Senator Wagner has so well called the outmoded dogma that the helpless must help themselves. A man off the payroll is a man on the tax roll. And whether or not business likes this as a philosophy, it must face it as a fact. There are those who answer that private enterprise can take care of itself, that all government needs to do is to let business alone. Let's see about that. It is important if true, and it isn't true. the circle of American private enterprise has never been continuously self-sustaining. It has always operated under concealed subsidies. Until the end of the last century, we operated a WPA by which the unemployed could get a quarter section of public land just for occupying it. Then came the second WPA, government borrowing and spending for the World War. After the war came the third WPA. We went into a foreign boondoggling program. American investors furnished funds, which they lost, which ran a WPA, building schools and highways and housing in Europe and South America. We no longer have these costly but concealed subsidies to take up the slack in employment. Private enterprise in America today is in a situation where chiefly its own workers are its customers, and its customers are its own workers. Unless it can keep the circle of goods and wages moving, then the government, directly and brazenly, must fill the gap in employment on one hand and the needs for goods on the other. We are right out in the open with sheer naked taxes on private enterprise for cash relief. That system can grow to heaven knows what. Government last year tried to cooperate with the business demand to get out of government spending, and the problem has come back with an increased intensity. What then can we do? There is, to my mind, an essential first step. That is for big business, deliberately and speedily, to go to a policy of high volume production, low price, and the highest wage scale possible. As one industry has put the philosophy, we must have more goods for more people at less cost. Steel prices cannot be geared to produce profits at 45% of capacity. Building materials must be priced so that building may go on from year to year as needed. Building prices cannot prosper. Building industries cannot prosper if we can afford to build only in the years when we can afford to be extravagant. In business that is really competitive, prices adjust themselves. But today, a few companies in each industry, grown so powerful that they can, by various devices not reached by present laws, hold prices up for a long time, even if they lose customers. They have a short-sighted philosophy that it is better policy in the long run to sell less goods at high prices than more goods at lower prices. Steel has declined in production from near 90% of capacity to near 30% without dropping the price a cent. It is interesting to know that even government cannot get really competitive bids for steel. For example, bids for reinforcement bars for Fort Peck Dam were filed by 10 companies, but each bid was exactly $253,633.80, identical to a penny. That could not happen in a truly competitive industry. Indeed, there are reputable economists who believe that it would not happen even in a wisely managed monopoly. Steel is not alone in this policy. Important basic industries, notably those supplying building materials, have followed the same policy and simply priced us out of a housing program. The other day, when General Motors laid off 30,000 men, Mr. Knudsen, their president, stated as one of the reasons, quote, "I think the price level rose too fast in the spring of 1937, and we just could not get adjusted to it," end of the quote. This dramatizes the fact that there is a silent economic conflict in this country between two kinds of industry. On the one hand, we have high-price, low-volume industries, largely in the monopoly or semi-monopoly class. On the other hand, we have competitive industry, large and small. Competitive industry is much dependent a non-competitive industry for its raw materials. The automobile industry as a whole has been competitive and has followed a high-volume, low-price policy. The unprecedented growth of this industry has been due to the fact that it did not shut down its plant and wait for the people to get rich enough to buy cars. It tried to make cars that people could buy without waiting to be rich. I hope to see the anti-monopoly laws enacted that will be adequate to throw the power of organized government back of those businesses that are pursuing a policy of serving the public with an abundance of goods at prices it can afford to pay. This brings us to another problem that faces both business and government. Mr. Knudsen gave another and very illuminating reason for laying off those 30,000 men. One reason was, he said, that new cars could not be sold. And the reason for that was that used cars could not be sold. In other words, one reason why those men are out of work tonight is that there is not enough buying power in that particular kind of people who would buy used cars if they could. But it has been the underlying policy of this New Deal administration to raise the incomes of just this sort of people. On June the 8th, 1937, I opened the congressional hearings on behalf of the president's proposal for a minimum wage bill to put a floor under depressed wages and to keep up purchasing power. The Wagner Labor Relations Act to give labor the right to collectively bargain so that it could intelligently and effectively protect its own purchasing power was an administration measure. Farm bills and relief measures have been advanced with the very purpose of helping purchasing power of this very low income group who are the people who are willing to take on the used car. I do not need to point out the opposition. It announces itself. Big business opposition, in my opinion, has been as short-sighted as suicide. A low-wage policy is inconsistent with the standard of living which American business is organized to serve. Unless it is willing to pay wages, which will sustain a high standard of American living, it cannot have a market for the commodities which only a high standard of living would call for. From these all-important things which the people want business to do, I now turn to an all-important thing they want business not to do. They do not want all of the business of the country to be swallowed up by a few corporations. So long as the American spirit lives and democracy survives so that its spirit can be expressed in law, the American Congress will be trying to break down the concentration of power just as fast as the imperialists of business pile it up. We are a proud people, raised on the doctrines of equality found in the Declaration of Independence. We do not like to be bossed too much, not even by a boss whom we know we can change through the ballot box. And we do not like to have any one man or corporation own the town. Because we are a democratic people, we are a friendly and sociable people. We know the corner grocer, the automobile dealer, the fellow who runs the factory, and the man who runs the bank. We know that they are harassed by the pressures of big competitors and the prices of big industries that control their supplies. We do not care if, and we do not believe it is true that, the big concerns that swallow up these local businessmen do any better job on the whole for our community. This fear of concentration, represented by an anti-big business feeling, is one of the strongest instincts in American politics. Through the centuries, the people have been afraid of anyone getting control of too much land because it was the basic resource of an agricultural civilization. The same instinct bids us now to keep power companies from getting too much of the nation's electric energy because that is a basic resource of the coming industrial civilization. This is the point where Mr. Wilkie has his difficulties with the government. Mr. Wilkie is a good operator, especially... especially with the TVA along beside of him to strengthen his resolve to be good. But Mr. Wilkie represents the control of utility systems in six states through one great holding company. It is the democratic instinct of our people that arises in the holding company law. People would feel more comfortable if Mr. Wilkie could control only two or three states. I seem to have been too generous with you. That simple illustration is typical of many of the contests between concentrated controls of business and popular government. We have no present substitute for the system of private enterprise motivated by private profit, whatever its defects. To my practical mind, our job is to make the system that is here work. It will take all of the strength and intelligence of both government and business to make it work under existing foreign and domestic stresses. But businessman asks, are there not risks in departing from old policies? Yes. Risk is the condition of winning. And consider the risks you take in not changing. Count the cost of not doing it against the cost of doing it. Business needs protection from stagnation far more than from adventure. Remember, the tax collector has to be most busy when industry is idle in order to complete the circle with tax funds. We must reform to conserve. Mr. Wilkie was one of the pioneers, stimulated no doubt by a little competition from TVA, in the adoption of a low price, high volume basis for his industry. He ventured and it paid. Business should get over thinking about men in public life as being different from themselves. There are dumb plays in government, matched by some in business. There is waste and incompetence in government. But get any good banker's opinion privately expressed of the operations of some of his debtors. I have seen politics interfere with good administration in government. I have also seen personal and family and banker politics do some pretty weird things in business. I have charged off enough small investments so that I am not sure that big businessmen are any more infallible than politicians. In fact, I don't know which brand of wisdom I distrust the most. That of the theorists who have studied a business but never run one, or that of the executives who have run a business but never studied it. The greatest difference between the man I meet in government and the man I meet in business is this. The man who is in government is brought in contact with the problems of all kinds and conditions of men. Everybody's business is his business. He looks at society, if he does his duty, as a whole mechanism rather than specializing the interest of a single business. Private businessman, on the other hand, up to now has been intensely preoccupied with a very narrow sector of the world. He has seldom looked about to see the effect which his acts may be having upon the lives of other people. It is this fundamental difference in viewpoint which occasions much of the conflict between business and government. The difficulty in getting along with business is not so much that it has a bad philosophy of the functions of government as that it has no philosophy of the broader functions of itself. It tends to make great strife over temporary irritations, and it passes unnoticed fundamental menaces to its long-range interests. Our need now is to settle upon a common objective for business and government. My little contribution is to suggest this program of high-volume, low-price industrial economy, which will sustain a high-wage scale, which in turn will support a high standard of living, which will demand and pay for the high volume production at prices determined by its wages. The economic organization must find ways in its bargaining, its ownership, and its management to provide for the play of our democratic instincts, the most fundamental force in American life. Regardless of any consequences, I am ready to go down the line to cooperate with anyone to foster this kind of American life. And I am just as ready to go down the line against anyone who tries to destroy this kind of American life.
We pause for station identification.
And now, thank you, Mr. Jackson. Are we ready to hear a slightly different point of view from Mr. Wendell L. Wilkie, President of the Commonwealth and Southern Corporation? Mr. Wilkie has asked me to state that he cannot and does not attempt to speak for all American industry. His statements and opinions are entirely his own, as I presume are Mr. Jackson. I take great pleasure in presenting Mr. Wendell L. Wilkie.
I wonder if it seems strange to any of you tonight that we should be discussing the question of whether or not the good government should cooperate with business. I have an idea that if from the town meetings of the past our forefathers should rise to attend this meeting, they would be a little puzzled by such a topic. They might ask with some surprise if it was not the function of American government to encourage the development of private enterprise. They would, of course, first be astonished that such a town meeting as this was possible at all, that several million people from all over the land should be gathered together by means of the mysterious network of the air. They would want to be told about this big business of radio manufacturing, which in 15 years, by large-scale production, has cut the price of its product by three-fourths and sold it to nearly 25 million families. And after they had learned about these things, they would, I think, be even more puzzled as to why, over the facilities made possible by American business genius, we should be discussing whether or not American business, big or little, should be encouraged to proceed. For several years now, we have been listening to a bedtime story. Telling us that the men who hold office in Washington are by their very position endowed with a special virtue, that they are men of far vision, of exceptional ability and capacity. Businessmen, on the other hand, particularly so-called big businessmen, are pictured as the ruthless dictators of sprawling industrial empires with no real ability except the talent for collecting money for themselves. Most of you who are here tonight and listening to this broadcast will remember Cho or Tom or Dick or someone else who left your town and went to the city and made a name for himself in business. Most business leaders today were just such small town boys. You will remember also other Toms and Dicks and Joes who went into local politics and then into federal politics, perhaps in one of the many administrative bureaus in Washington today. On the basis of your own experience, which of these, the businessman or the man in politics, wears the longer horns or sports the whiter wings? Would you, from what you know personally, consider the politician to have the greater ability and the more noble character? I tell you quite frankly that I find no halo on the head of either. I have known men in government who were excessively greedy for power, and I likewise have known men in business who were excessively greedy for money. But this is not typical of either group. And whatever other monopolies Mr. Jackson may claim to find, I know he has not found, even among government officials, a monopoly upon virtue. But there's another myth that's been handed out to us in recent years, and that is that big business and small business have different and opposing interests. My distinguished companion on the platform has made this a favorite theme of his many speeches. He has warned against government cooperation with big business, maintaining that, to quote his word, the governmental cooperation which the small businessman wants is of a different kind. The fact of the matter is that small business and big business prosper under exactly the same conditions, and the conditions that are harmful to one are harmful to the other. In fact, small business suffers more acutely from such things as heavy taxation, governmental hostility, and timidity of investment because it has no reserves with which to preserve itself in times of adversity. When we say that American industry is prosperous, we mean that the small business of America, which comprises the larger part of our industry, is prosperous. After all, a large corporation is simply a corporation in which, as a rule, the interest is divided among a great many small stockholders. It is not the size that makes a corporation bad or good, it is the way it operates.
For example, the government has been currently investigating most of the major industries of the country, such as the oil industry, automobiles, telephone, telegraph, utilities, and railroads. These are typical big business industries. What have they achieved? Do they make a good product? Is it sold at a fair price? Does labor receive a fair wage? Well, every American working man knows that the highest wages and the best working conditions are found in the large corporations. If the wage and hour bill is passed, the effect on America's big business corporations will be negligible because their wage levels are already above the minimum suggested in the bill. Also, it seems a little ironical for government officials to be lecturing big business on the desirability of low price and large volume, because this is the technique which was developed and made possible only by mass production and distribution under the leadership of big business. The oil industry, for example, is one in which there are a number of very large companies of the kind Mr. Jackson dislikes. Yet anyone who has driven a car abroad knows that the system of service stations, which we take for granted here, is duplicated in very few places outside of our borders. Although nearly one half of what we pay for gasoline represents tax we can still buy it for less than in almost any other place in the world. And of course, no country pays refinery workers as high a wage as they receive here. In fact, the average hourly wage rates in refineries have increased more than 50% in the past 15 years, while the gasoline price, excluding tax, has declined by nearly the same amount. More than 50% of all the telephones in the world are in the United States, and they cost the consumer a smaller part of his income than anywhere else. During the 4 years prior to 1933, the American automobile industry lost 80% of its business. In 1 year, the industry's net loss was half the cost of the Panama Canal. Yet during that 4 year period, the industry made a low priced car, which was better than the highest priced car made in 1926. The public got a better car for considerably less money. And the reduction in price did not come out of the pockets of labor, because automobile labor continued to be among the highest paid of all manufacturing industries. Here again was big business that made the achievement possible. At a press conference in 1936, President Roosevelt quoted with approval a remark made by Mr. Walter P. Chrysler, stating that because of the efficient production methods made possible by the big automobile companies, we could buy an automobile for $600 a day, which otherwise would cost $3,500. The president stated at the time that the same method should be applied to the housing industry. Of all the industries mentioned, the utility industry, with its enormous demand for additional construction and equipment, is the most important to our economic recovery. And how has it been operated? Since the pre-war years, the cost of living has gone up about 40%, and the cost of electricity in this country has gone down by almost exactly the same percent. The American consumer pays a smaller part of his income for electricity than the consumers in any country in Europe. On an average, the American citizen pays 9 cents a day for electricity, less than the government tax on a package and a half of cigarettes. Since Mr. Jackson has at times employed the usual government arguments against utility holding companies, perhaps we should note here that electricity costs less when it is supplied by one of the great utility holding company systems. In every one of the 48 states of the United States, you will find in operation both the so-called independent utility, which are unaffected by the death sentence of the Utility Holding Company Act, and also utility companies affiliated with holding companies. In 44 of those 48 states, the rates of companies in holding company systems are lower than the rates of the independent companies. For example, Mr. Jackson lives in Washington, D.C., at least temporarily. Which gets its electricity from one of the companies in the great North American holding company system. A few miles away, operating under identical conditions, is one of those so-called independent companies. The average rate for electric service in the Washington home is 3 cents per kilowatt hour. The average rate for this same service in this independent company's territory is 4 cents, or 33 1/3% higher. Because of the low rates,
of the holding company utility, the homeowners of Washington save approximately $1.5 million per year in their electricity bill, which is worth more to the people of that city, a saving of $1.5 million on the electricity they use, or the acceptance of a political formula which decrees that mere size is wrong, even though it saves money for the people. I use Washington as an example because Mr. Jackson comes from there. Similar comparisons can be made in almost every state of the Union. Mr. Jackson is mistaken. The Commonwealth and Southern operates in 11 states, 5 of them in the North. The Commonwealth and Southern Corporation has 5 northern companies wholly remote from the Tennessee Valley Authority. The average rates of these companies and our southern companies is lower than that of any utility group in America. No doubt there have been weaknesses and abuses in all the industries which I have mentioned, and in others too. Betrayals of trust have stained the record of public officials as well as of businessmen. In the period following the Great War, there was a breakdown in both governmental and in private morals. For the first time in history, a member of the presidential cabinet was sent to the penitentiary. Some of those who were in charge of the hospitals for America's war veterans were indicted and some convicted for stealing the very blankets and towels provided for the care of those men who were injured in their country's service. Speaking of abuses in his relief program, President Roosevelt stated, "It should be remembered that in every big job there are imperfections. There are chiselers in every walk of life. There are those in every industry who are guilty of unfair practices. Every profession has its black sheep." If this quotation from President Roosevelt represents what our attitude should be towards the mistakes of a few in government, and I think it does, then that should also be our attitude towards industry. In view of the friendlier tone of the president's last speeches, I hope that at last we can have done with the epithets, the calling of names, the catchwords which have been so glibly used, such as economic royalists, bourbons, money aristocrats, banker control, holding companies, and the nonsense about 60 ruling families. A good catchword, Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes said, can obscure analysis for 50 years. Today we are very much in need of analysis without catchwords. The business decline has become so serious that government officials who at first thought to minimize it are seeking frantically to make big business responsible. Some of those officials allege that the present slump was caused by a few business strongmen who, like Samson, were willing to destroy themselves in order to pull down the house. They would have us believe that the automobile companies are deliberately trying not to sell cars. They would have us believe that the steel companies, which were operating at 90% of capacity, are now purposely losing money and operating at 20% of capacity, and that they increased their prices for no reason. Whereas, in fact, these prices increased less than wages and the cost of materials. However absurd this charge may be, I see no point in arguing it. I suggest that we have now reached the time when we should stop discussing what caused the depression and should direct our attention to how to cure it. The real cure consists in convincing the millions of small investors throughout America that the government does not intend to continue its attack on American industry. Big or little, for it is these investors upon whom industry depends for its funds. For instance, the utilities need to spend several hundred million dollars for new construction, but they can only raise the money by selling securities. The investor will buy securities only if he thinks that he will get a safe and a fair return. He knows that the government is now competing with private industry in the Tennessee Valley by selling electricity at less than cost and charging the loss to the federal treasury. He knows that the government is giving money away to municipalities with which to duplicate existing distribution lines. And he will not invest his money in utilities merely because someone says that the government is competing in only 15% of the country's area. If there is a smallpox epidemic in a city, you cannot convince a man he is in no danger because at the moment only 15% of the city is affected. The investor knows that if the government can compete in 15% of the United States, it can compete with any industry anywhere, and he is not reassured by government efforts to belittle or conceal the competition. Mr. Jackson has previously spoken of the strike of capital against the government. If there is any strike of capital, it comes from these millions of small investors, not from the wealthy few. As a matter of fact, due to the income tax laws, which take up to 83% of a rich man's investment in private enterprise, most of the very rich have been investing more and more in the flood of tax-exempt government securities. It might be helpful to industry, as well as to government revenues, if the government should remove these tax exemptions. But this in and of itself would not be enough. The main problem is to restore confidence of investors in American business. And to do this will require more than pleasant speaking on the part of the government. For several years, the government has taken definite action to show its hostility to business. It must now take definite action to demonstrate the sincerity of its desire to cooperate. I don't think that such cooperation should be difficult. The chief reason why government officials and businessmen fail to understand each other is because one thinks and speaks the language of politics and emotionalism, while the other thinks and speaks the language of economics and of realism. One thinks economic forces can be controlled by politics, while the other realizes that economic forces are more powerful than either government or business. But if we look behind this difference in theory, we can find much upon which we agree in practice. For example, there seems to be no important disagreement today on the need for a reduction in the undistributed profit tax, which falls with particular severity upon small business, and both of which restrict the expansion of industry. Nor is there any general agreement as to the principles of the social legislation which has been put upon the statute books in recent years. Time has revealed both the virtues and the weaknesses of these laws. The proposal now is simply one of eliminating the weaknesses, of modifying those restrictions upon the buying and selling of securities that hamper the investment of funds, or of readjusting the Social Security Act to a pay-as-you-go basis so that money paid by the people for Social Security is used only for that purpose. Of protecting the rights of both capital and labor in the promotion of collective bargaining, of getting rid of intermediate holding companies in the utility industry without declaring a death sentence upon all of them,
6 weeks ago, I left with the president a memorandum suggesting a solution of the utility problem, a solution which did not ask for less federal regulation of utilities, but did ask for an end to unfair government competition and unfair government destruction of the property of American citizens. I am still hopeful of that memorandum will provide a basis upon which the utilities may be permitted to go ahead with their construction plan. Now, is there anything in this outline of a possible relationship between government and business that is not in the interest of the ill-housed, the ill-fed, and the ill-clad? Is there anything here that is opposed to the social regulation of business? Does this attitude imply that business is ganging up on government, or that a few corporations are attempting to swallow up American industry? In such a time as this, when we see the relief rolls lengthening again and the price of farm products declining, when many of us are discouraged and when the road to recovery seems long, surely government and business should put an end to the bitternesses of recent years and sit down in conference like reasonable men with mutual tolerance and respect. But the purpose of this conference must not only be to plan intelligently for the future, but to review those laws which have been passed to see whether they cannot be so modified as to stimulate business activity without removing any of the appropriate social controls. And above all, while these conferences are proceeding, the American people should be spared the confusion of hearing what one government official says in friendship today, denied by another in hostility tomorrow. At this critical point in our nation's history, it should seem fitting that business and government should bear in mind the warning which Abraham Lincoln gave to the two factions into which this country was dividing at the time of his first inaugural address. I am loath to close. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies, I think.
You're cutting your own time short, I'm afraid, my friends. Mr. Wilkie, my good friend, has taken a little more than his allotted time, and as the clock is our only. And I'm afraid you took it, good deal of it for him. As the clock is our only yardstick of fair play, Mr. Jackson is entitled to 6 minutes, which he tells me he would rather waive in favor of the questions. Now, please save your own time and don't take up time applauding and demonstrating. Let's have your questions. We only have about 6 minutes. Questions, please. Yes?
Mr. Jackson.
Yes?
You made reference to a statement made by Mr. Knudsen. I had a chance to read his testimony before the Senate. I'll get to the question. You let me finish my statement so Mr. Jackson can answer me. He made a statement before the Senate committee today that the reason the sale of automobiles had declined was not because the people were thrown out of work and had no money to buy, but that even though they had the money, they were afraid to buy, lest they had no job in the future. In other words, there was a period of uncertainty ahead which prompted them to withhold purchasing power.
Unfortunately, I have not read Mr. Knudsen's testimony, and I don't like to comment on testimony that I haven't heard. I did read his statement, as quoted in the New York Times, at the time that the 30,000 men were discharged, and I am not surprised if, as a result of that, there is a good deal of uncertainty in the hearts and minds of a good many working men as to where their jobs last.
I'd like to ask Mr. Wilkie whether big business or small business is more likely to hire labor spies.
Mr. Wilkie, do you want to comment on that?
Certainly. Being a member of big business and never hired a labor spy in my life, I don't know the motive that actuates either a big or a little business, and I would repudiate both.
Jackson.
do you reconcile the New Deal program for farmers to cut production to raise prices with their idea of increasing industrial production to lower prices?
How do you reconcile what the gentleman considers as an inconsistency in raising farm prices and lowering industrial prices?
Every person who has ever lived upon a farm knows that there is an essential difference in the method of production on a farm and the production in a factory. No farmer can control his production unless he can control the weather, and that's one of the things we haven't got around to regulate yet. Now, just one word more. Factory production is controlled and can be controlled, which makes an entirely different matter.
Jackson, don't we fear, we the people, an undue concentration in government as much or more than we fear this concentration in business which distresses you so?
Yes, sir, we do fear it. We do fear it. And the American people never would concentrate government if they didn't have to concentrate government to regulate the concentration of big business. How can a single state regulate Mr. Wilkie?
I'll answer you. That might be that in Italy or Germany, but it isn't that in the United States of America.
Yeah, Mr. Wilkie, what accounts for the Canadian electric rates being so much less than the rates of the utility company on this side of the Niagara?
What accounts for Canadian rates as compared with ours?
I was just hoping somebody would ask me that question. The difference is that the American utility companies are now paying up to 20% of their gross revenues in taxes, while the public plants in Canada pay no taxes except a minor amount of tax on real estate.
Mr. Wilkie, you mentioned in your address that the large corporations have the higher wage scale and the better working conditions. Isn't that fact negated by the large labor turnover in large corporations?
Wilkie, will you comment on the... Well,
personally, I disagree with you about the fact. In the utility business, there's practically no turnover in labor. Most of our employees have been with us for more than 10 years. I would say that the policy of American industry, as well illustrated by the attitude of General Motors, has been to attempt to make the production regular so that men may be employed as much as possible throughout the year and reduce to the minimum the turnover in labor.
Mr. Jackson, don't you think that in your first statement you rather settled the whole thing when you said you were a little lawyer of little business and yet you're in Washington?
Come.
Now, I thought we were going to have fair play and no personal questions. Let's rule that kind of question out. You know, that doesn't go. Yes?
Mr. Wilkie. What do you think the attitude of government should be towards the cement industry, which controls prices throughout the country?
Mr. Wilkie, can you comment on the cement industry?
There is on the statute books antitrust statutes. You have seen demonstrated tonight one of the most brilliant legal minds charged with the prosecution of any violation of that statute. I would suggest that Mr. Jackson go to work if there's anything wrong in the cement industry or in any other industry with reference to monopoly.
Let me remind you that you're not going to solve the problem by expressing your feelings. If you want to save your own time, you'll stop the demonstrations. Let's go on with the questions.
Mr. Jackson. What does Mr. Jackson think about the undistributed profit surtax?
What about the undistributed profit surtax?
The undistributed profits tax, undoubtedly, is in need of amendment in several particulars, particularly as affects small industry. I want to say to you that I believe in the undistributed profits tax in the main. I know
that the representations that have been made that corporate surpluses are a cushion against depression are not true, because General Motors, when it laid off 30,000 men, had over $400 million of corporate surplus.
Said that the government, that farm production could not be controlled, then why did the government attempt it in the case of cotton?
Jackson, if farm products can't be controlled, why does the government attempt it in the case of cotton?
The most that the government attempted to do was to place a maximum of production and to avoid the creation of a surplus which could not be handled, since the foreign markets had fallen away due to the fact that we had quit sending foreign money abroad with which they could buy back our product. Next question.
Jackson.
Mr. Jackson. Yes? Quiet, please.
If the government continues its expansion program in the power field, what will happen to the billions of dollars invested in stocks and bonds now held by our insurance companies, investment trusts, the states, and the public?
Yes, I have that question. The government of the United States has never attempted to destroy the power industry.
Not much.
The government of the United States wants the power industry to furnish power at rates that are fair to the public as well as the utility. Just one moment more. Long before I was in politics, I pointed out to the utility industry in an address to the American Bar Association utility lawyers that the trouble with the credit of the power industry was that it was issuing too many securities called power securities that had little relation to power and none to security.
Mr. Jackson.
Jackson.
Stand by. Do you think the right way to get low electric rate is to subsidize municipal competition with 50% grants and free taxation?
I don't think... Do you want to ask a question?
No.
I don't think the question of fairness enters into it. I don't know that it's necessarily fair for two policemen to arrest one crook. But the government of the United States, if it's going to carry out a power policy, has got to use competitive methods, because we have seen the methods of regulation break down.
Are your rates lower in TVA, I mean in Commonwealth and Southern, because of the pressure from TVA? That's the question.
Now, as I said, we operate in 11 states. 5 in the north and 6 in the south. Our rate schedules in our major northern companies are almost identical with the rate schedules in our southern companies. Only those in the north are a little lower. The Tennessee Valley Authority, in response to what Mr. Jackson said, is building competitive lines, and the federal government is giving 45% absolutely free with which to duplicate existing utility systems, where the average rate of the Tennessee Electric Power Company is less than 3 cents, which is 25% to 30% below the national average. And those properties will be destroyed, and the investors will lose their money if this policy, which Mr. Jackson recognizes has no element of fairness in it, is not discontinued.
Is it the aim of the New Deal ultimately to nationalize all the public utilities, or is the present warfare against the public utilities a mere political expedient to catch the votes of the government?
Is it the aim of the New Deal to nationalize all of the public utilities? We take that first vote.
I should say no. I haven't heard of its nationalizing any public utilities.
Yes? Your question.
Has it occurred to Mr. Jackson? Yes, Mr. Jackson. Has it occurred to Mr. Jackson that the price government power operation quotes does not include the interest on the capital invested in the form of the taxpayers' money, nor for provision for amortization of the debt? In other words, an incomplete balance sheet is presented to the American public and endorsed as bona fide by the government. What is the difference between this procedure and Mr. Insull's?
Mr. Jackson, you want to comment on that? Mr. Jackson, is the government accounting, I think the purport of the question is the government accounting on its production of power accurate and fair? Is that your question?
I'm not an accountant, and if I were, I wouldn't attempt to discuss an accounting question in the time that's allowed here. I don't know the details of the accounting of TVA, and I don't know the details of the accounting of private utilities.
We must close now, and I hope that all who are listening in as groups will continue their discussion as profitably as I know we're going to continue it here among ourselves as we leave this hall.